There we are. Final one, Rich.
Final one, Dennis. It's great to be on here again. Welcome to anyone watching now live or watching later or listening in on the podcast. My name is Richard Moy.
And I'm Dennis Adide.
Dennis Adide, rapidly becoming famous in the Church of England and beyond.
That's a positive thing.
You're a positive thing. That's the thing. So we're going to have a sort of wrap-up conversation tonight. It's the final one. We've broken the trilogy and gone for the... What do you call it if there's four? It's a quadrilogy or something like that? Quadrilogy? We probably ought to pray if we're going to get anything out of this. Is it your turn or mine?
I'll talk to Jesus. I like to. You've got to be part of all of this, Lord God, by your Spirit in our hearts, in our minds, guiding our tongues, preparing our ears to hear each other and from you. Otherwise, it's all a waste. We need you to guide us. We need you to challenge us. We need you to really steer where our hearts go. I pray that both of us, Rich and I, are really attentive to you. And I pray for everyone watching and listening, Lord God, that you may open their hearts to hear and discern your voice. Mm-hmm. Learn your way, to be led by you, either to the meadow, the grass, or to the valley, wherever life is and wherever you lead. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Well, the point of this episode is to sort of give us some trajectory going forward, some sort of resolution, if that's possible, or at least enough unresolution to give us carry forward. But before we get there, just remind us of why we kicked off this series. What was the inspiration behind it, if that's the right word?
Well, I suppose I was speaking on Sunday and I reminded the folks in church that this lady who very much I'm drawn to because of my sister was shot in her own house by a group of police officers who had already apprehended the person they were looking for. Yeah. And it emerged last week that from the footage that they have and the audio they recorded, that she was alive for five more minutes and asking for help. And those who could have saved her life didn't. We're doing this because people have died. George Floyd triggered a lot of what led us to have these conversations. Mm. We're doing this because people continue to die. And by that, I mean both losing their lives, but also, in a sense, being denied living. And this is people in workplaces, and especially for us church folk, people in our church, is there's folk struggling to find places to fulfill their calling. There's folks in meetings today who are suffering, unable to really express who they are. And so this is Kingdom of God dialogue, because parts of the body are not flourishing as God would intend for them to. So yeah, that's the sobering reminder, I think. The dialogue is important.
It makes me want to ask the sort of follow-on question. What's the danger from this? We sort of called it a cultural moment, a sort of a kairos moment, maybe an opportunity to think and reflect. And what's the danger? What might we miss if this sort of thing just fades away? Or if we, you know, I've sat through those seminars, or I've done the seminars coming up at New Wine next week, or and we just go, yeah, okay, I get that now. There was a historic problem. What's the danger?
So when you want to vaccinate someone against something, you give them a weaker version of that illness. And
church schools.
Seriously, the danger here is people pick up all the texts we're recommending. People listen to our dialogue. People watch all this happen, and it's already began to sort of die off, and now become sort of inoculated against the real horror of what life is like for some in our world, in our communities who live and walk among us. And so the danger is the cultural moment becomes just that, a cultural moment that comes and goes. And we remember 2020 as that weird year when a lot of things happened. We had a pandemic, George Floyd happened, there were protests. Just, you know, I mean, hopefully Trump got voted out. Hashtag no politics. we just kind of name it as that and then return to the very seductive default setting. It's so seductive because it's so comfortable.
And even in that throwaway line about Trump, though, there's a sort of an othering, isn't there, where it's like, if America sorts it out, if Trump sorts it out, if, he's refused to put up portraits of Barack Obama and Michelle Obama, maybe it's someone else's problem. But a lot of what we've been sort of grazing on has been the sense that actually othering of people is something that we all do. And to call that racism, we're all racist to one degree or another, aren't we? I've been reading up a bit on some African current affairs and history at the moment, and extraordinary to see some of the blatant racism in Sudan, for example, the North versus South, and some of the way that people describe the black population in South Sudan as slaves is the vernacular from North Sudan at the moment, and more lighter skinned Arab population there. Othering we all do, don't we? Given that othering is such an almost, I won't call it natural, but quite a default setting for a lot of us, why did you want to have this dialogue for the two of us? I mean, in some ways, we've got a lot in common. Some ways, not so much. What were you hoping for?
So, I suppose there are two things that could emerge from this. I want to play the game and fast forward it. The reality is, even a place like Africa won't be in the same circumstance as it was and currently is. It's actually on a positive trajectory. Mm-hmm. The landscape where those who are othered will continue to be othered is actually a dangerous landscape. Look what happened in France with the revolution. Mm-hmm. The reality is, if things don't shift or change, or at least an example is set for a different way of people interacting and engaging with a clear understanding of what the present state is and what's contributed to it, then I suppose violence becomes the only outcome. If othering continues, violence lives on. And the only thing the caged tiger is gonna do once it's been prodded enough is come out swinging. And I personally don't think that that's the kingdom of God. I think the kingdom of God has a face that is full on embrace mode. We did a module at college on reconciliation, and I think that's where my mind has settled on this. Is that for the journey to be truly godly, the aim isn't just parity. The aim is something like this, where the idea of othering vanishes. So that's what I'm fighting. That's what I'm heading towards. Why a conversation with you in particular, Rich? Well, one, we've had robust conversations before, and we're still friends.
I had to write your mid-year report.
And even that, if you can imagine having a dialogue with someone who has that authority and power over your life and how people would perceive you. Reaching for the truth in a circumstance like that is not easy. And so actually there is something going on here where I'm saying to myself, with whom is it going to be hard for me to stay vulnerable? You see what I mean? With whom can I trust with that level of vulnerability? And with whom is it, if I went down the route of othering, could I possibly just put on the furthest end of the scale? And so in my estimation, this dialogue is important because for me, I think you almost are my other. If you can see it visibly on the screen, you see what I mean? And if me and you can do this, then there is hope. There is hope. We can embody something visibly and with our dialogue and our care for each other in these dialogues, which will help others who we sort of resemble, just here, I mean, to see the possibility of actually dialoguing about these very difficult issues in a way that allows both of us to engage with it at our own pace. And that's the hope, to avoid the violence by essentially giving tools for people to discuss the difficult issues on the journey towards reconciliation and a proper embrace.
One of the things that's always hard is change, isn't it, in life? People find change difficult. And I was having a conversation on race with a friend of mine, and not a church guy, as a white guy, is married to a person of colour. She's got a mixed heritage of Asian and African background and Caribbean background. And he was describing the sort of racism of his parents towards his wife and towards their grandchildren, it was fascinating because it was a racism done despite loving their daughter-in-law and their grandchildren. It was just the sort of what might be seen as or historically have been sort of the casual words that people threw away, and he's like, you can't say that anymore. But for a generation of people, integrated race was a change dynamic, wasn't it? Some of the communities you can work in London, around the country, are ones where there's a sense of possible loss and bereavement of a culture that used to exist in a community, a white working class often community, saying, yeah, this used to be like this, but then others came. And that's obviously taken a long time for people to sort of settle into. And what got me thinking on that was, in America at the moment, it seems that there's a sort of a tipping point in terms of racial identity, like the percentage of white is proportionally less and less decade on decade. Go over to the island of Ireland, and the Catholic is just tipping over in Northern Ireland as well as in Ulster. So that's nearly majority. And when you get to those tipping points, that's where it can be. The fear again goes up. You get an initial fear when it's the first sort of sense of I'm losing something, and you get another fear when you get a sense of I'm no longer got power. And the thing that's sort of correlated with that, which I thought was really interesting to explore with you tonight, if I may, was I was reading an article on geopolitics, and they were saying that the world population is likely to peak in 2067, which surprised me. And yet the population in sub-Saharan Africa will increase, and that will rise to 3 billion. In other countries, it's going to decrease. And in Europe, it's already decreasing. You need, as you know, you need 2.1 children per couple to sustain a population. And in the white populations, generally, that's that figure's nowhere near. So what they were arguing in this is that there'll come a point where the so-called rich countries will be desperately pleading with countries from sub-Saharan Africa to migrate into, say, England, because to sustain the economy and sustain the number of old people in the economy, you'll desperately need migration, sort of the opposite of the Farage thing. So whereas now we have, you know, a lot of our NHS, our care system is propped up by, say, people from all over the world, there'll be a sense of where is there a young population, and we'll be pleading for the scarce resource of labour to come to these countries, which will potentially bring tipping point. And this is a long point, so I'll give you a long time to respond. one of the things that has struck me a lot in this conversation is that what we see on our screens often is America, and America is much more racially diverse than the UK currently is. Although in London, you don't necessarily see that all the time. The whole of the UK is 87% white. If you go to Kent out on Rochester, it's sort of 93-94% white running through. Going south there is it gets higher, obviously, in cities, more diverse. What do you how do I make this into a good question or point? What do you plot as a future going forward in terms of maybe helping those who have sort of found what they saw as their normal disappear, and then maybe those who think, actually, this now feels like more of a threat to me than, you know, it's okay when I could go, yeah, I'm a liberal, pro everything. But if it looks like fundamental change, that feels a bit different to me.
So this is my thesis so far, Rich. And I suppose it runs through most of what I've said through the four sessions. Selfishness is extremely easy to systematize. And that's the thing behind the thing. And so for so long as the conversation is about how do I keep what I have, Jesus is all the way over there. He's not involved. And that's what the lament becomes. It becomes, we had this thing, and we've had this thing for so long, but now we don't have it anymore. I see it here in Shepherd's Bush. I remember coming to Shepherd's Bush 10 to 15 years ago. I can say that now. I'm in my
mid-30s. Come on.
And you would hear the dub plates from Bush Market, you know, and you'd walk the street and it looked very different from what it looks like now. Now, if you come to Shepherd's Bush, it's very different. If you walk the street, it's very different. If you come to the church that I lead, it's very different. It does not look like the Shepherd's Bush that I remember. Mm. In fact, if you meet people from, say, the Caribbean or something, and Africans who'd settled here before, there's a lovely church we meet in our church who've been here 40 years, they will tell you Shepherd's Bush has changed and some of what was there has been lost. I struggle with assessing space and even this word culture and economics based on what's already there. I really struggle with that, and personally it's because I've moved a lot. I've been a nomad, so every new space I've got into, I've had to find my way. And the one thing that I've recognized in most of the people really has been this way of trying to keep what you have. And me being, as the outsider coming into it, a threat. And that's the threat. I think we cannot build a future on that. There's no way to manage what's to come over our lifetime. 2067, we'll still be alive. There's no way to manage what will come over our lifetime if we are afraid to lose what we already have. So it's not, the conversation isn't, let's find a way to mitigate change happening. It's actually, change is happening. Let's be realistic about it and find a way to love each other through it. I don't also think that the world and the political sphere can resolve this issue, because primarily this is an issue at the center of people's hearts, and which is why it, for this session, the thing that's been at the top of my mind and heart is what Jesus gives us is a way to systematize the most difficult thing to systematize, which is compassion. It's a way to systematize loving the other. That's what it gives us. And I don't think our success is going to be the whole world having let go of othering. Our success is going to be demonstrating how compassion can be lived out by people systematically in a globe where actually the appeal of this of the heart to look out for itself, to keep what its own, has shaped us into borders. I'm from northern Uganda, so the folks from southern Sudan, those are my people, those are my tribesmen. I trace my lineage to them, you know. And so when I talk about the border between us, it's a split between our families, and that's a visible an economic even representation of this sense of how can we keep what's ours and its impact on the landscape. And so, yes, without borders, people would migrate. And I think they did it before we set these borders in place. They did it. I think that's a reality. It probably would have been easier for them to transition and we wouldn't face the same sort of crises. I don't think that that time was peaceful or more peaceful than now. I don't think that that time had no othering. I actually think a lot more happened back then than we recognize.
Yeah.
What I do know is the future needs the church. And by that, I don't mean the Anglican Church. I don't mean any particular denomination. I mean those who follow this man, Jesus. Because in him is codified in the way he has taught his disciples, lived his life, told the story of God's love through the whole scripture, all the way through to the New Testament, is this story of codifying and systematizing compassion so that when people see how we treat each other, when they see how we deal with each other, in contrast to how the world chooses to do that, they look at it and they go, here is the kingdom of God. This is it. It's the calling that Israel still has now, and it's the calling the church has now. It's to embody something, to demonstrate something, a way of living, a way of loving that is just such an indictment to what else lives. In hope and in wait, in Advent for when the King comes, because when he comes, you're kind of now, you know, you can move to wherever you want to. I want to walk the surface of the sun. That will come when the King comes. Until then, we are called to do this, to show his love by the way that we love one another. And that's compassion systematized.
And I think there's some... It's such an interesting point, compassion systematized. I love that phrase. One of the ways that people have talked about sin, historically we have it in our liturgy, is that the world, the flesh and the devil are all things that can draw you away from God. Is it with anti-racism or to put it in a different term, compassion systematized, that you can find an antidote to each of those things, the world, the flesh and the devil? Does that make sense as a category? The sense that there's some racism which is just that othering that you might have if someone came into the primitive tribal people who was from outside, you'd have a sense of pulling up your horses and protecting yourself. That's almost a very natural protectiveness that goes on. And there's the devil, which sort of is that sort of malevolent force that we see through history at different times. Where the KKK, the Holocaust, different forms of obviously evil, malevolent othering. And then the systematized version, the world, where it's just built in. And we talked a lot about that last week, and the legacy of colonialism, the legacy of slavery. Can love be an antidote to all those things? Can systematic compassion be an antidote to the world, the flesh and the devil?
If you're someone with skin that doesn't look like mine and looks like Rich, and you're listening to what I'm saying, what I want you to hear me say now, also to people who look like me, is this: the road of loving is hardest for the giver, and a gift to the one who receives it. And so, I don't even know if I'm prepared emotionally. I know that for this kind of love to be seen, known, understood, experienced, and learned from, it's going to be extremely costly to to those who have already borne the cost of that state of play not being present. How do I know that? Because Jesus, in all these things that he faces, the sin, the world and the devil, he will come back with us with wrath, with a mighty hand. But when he was among us enfleshed, he was so gentle, he was so kind, he was over the top generous. He spoke the truth, and he let the truth be his shield. And the thing about the truth is, it doesn't fight with swords and spears. It yields and opens to be pierced. And this doesn't land well for me, because I hear the challenge of my Savior saying to me, actually, in the weeks and months to come, in the years to come, you're going to have to embrace those who come at you because you look different. You're going to have to love them. You're going to have to endure much in order for the way my kingdom is supposed to be understood and seen, to be seen, understood, experienced, learned from, and then lived out. And so sin, the world, and what I'd suggest is the issue in the heart cannot be solved by a systematized thing. That needs repentance before the cross. The systematized compassion cannot be lived out unless that work of repentance has already begun. And it's what happens when you hear Jesus say, give everything and follow me, pick up your cross. It's what happens when you hear Jesus say, let the dead bury the dead. And he says those kind of tougher things. It's what happens when he says, look, I'm beckoning you to follow me. Now we're going into the valley of the shadow of what looks like death. And when we stand before kings like Stephen, like Saul, like Thomas, like Peter, like all these people, when we stand before kings and princes, what are they going to do? They're going to other us. That's what they're going to do. And so we have to love, 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 love. So, yeah, I'm saying this so that you who are listening, you who is listening, can hear, I suppose, the calling that's already upon those who resemble me and who in one way or another are othered, to not pull the horse away, to actually, in that point where the instinct is to go protect what I have, to open and go for the embrace.
Yeah, yeah.
It's in that space that all the different layers of sinfulness expressed in this way that the world is now starts to get undone. It's costly.
When we listen to you, we hear someone who, although you name the cost, I think you're not someone who would ever play the victim, if that makes sense. And you know, you're wanting to come out. Fighting's the wrong word, but there's a sense you want to take matters into your own hands and through love, through the gospel, through Christ, bring transformation. How much does your sort of political bent affect how you deal with injustice? And to explain that question, I was listening to a viral video on Facebook from a black Republican voting woman. I think it's, you know, there's probably not so many of them, so you could probably work out which one it was. But she's one of these incredibly eloquent, passionate speakers, and a fantastically well presented 20-minute speech. And in it, she basically says, George Floyd is not my martyr. He's someone who put a gun at a pregnant woman's belly. He's a misogynist. He was a criminal. It's not my martyr, and my community needs to stand up for itself, stop being a victim, and make a change for itself. It's got to not expect anyone to give handouts and so forth. And when you look at different groups of people, maybe ethnic, maybe other categories who've migrated to other places, there are different result we were looking at it last week a bit, different results in terms of educational attainment, different results in terms of financial attainment. Is there a point when you sort of talk into various Black communities and with one political hat on, you go, this is an injustice and we need to fight for the injustice, we need to overcome the oppressor, and with a different political hat on, you go, this is injustice, I've just got to do what's right for me and my family so that in future generations we're the ones who are prosperous? And is there is a simplicity in that of there's a sort of a right wing left wing politics? Is it inevitable that those who are oppressed in one generation remain oppressed, or can communities lift themselves out of it? I know you've got lots to say on this, but it was a great way to give you a platform.
First thing, just to sort of let you know where I stand on, and I'll name her Candace Owens, is don't waste your time. And I say this primarily because I'm a Christian and I love Jesus. I'm less interested in actual politics. And if you can hear much of what I've been saying all along, I've not been saying to you, go vote for this person or that person. I am pointing the arrow straight at the heart. And that's I think, where the business needs to happen. Saying to someone, stop being a victim, is a contradictory statement, because by the time they are a victim, it's not really in their hands. And so what I want to say to that is, actually, from a purely Christian perspective, what we learn in Jesus is that the place of the victim is the most powerful place in the universe. There is no more powerful place than that, where you stand and you're accused, you are mocked, you are beaten, you are forced to carry this cross after all the lashes, you are deserted by your friends, betrayed by one who kissed you, you know, like your mom watches you die on the cross. You're put in a tomb. Victim of victims of victims is vindicated. Why? Because the reason he is a victim is because of the truth that he has chosen to live by. And so this comes as a challenge to people of color. It comes as a challenge to Native Americans in America, that actually it's in the space of adhering to the truth and loving that the victim finds their most power. Because if you're victimized in that space, guess who is your backup? It is Mr. Sun, Moon, and Star Maker, the one who made the universe. And actually, in reality, you will be vindicated. You will stand victorious. And death, which is the one weapon the victimizer has, loses its sting. So I enter the conversation, not necessarily right-wing or left-wing. I think it's more complex than that. There's some things I'm very conservative about. There's some things I'm quite liberal about. Mm. But the one thing I'm clear on is the question to the heart here and now is, Jesus is beckoning you to let go of what you have. If you already have less, then the space of generosity with who you are, mind, body, and soul, is what you've been called to do, because that's where you're supposed to have been all along. It's to reduce the simplicity of what you own to just you, so that in the space of giving, whatever you receive, you give out. Generations will always try to oppress generations. The makeup of who's being oppressed might change, but I think the issue in the human heart is not going to change. And because selfishness is so easy to systematize, 10 years, maybe 15 years from now, it may be the case that we have Black faces who are oppressing others. It may be the case. That's just the reality of how the world is. Theologically speaking, strictly speaking, human beings try, from Abel and Cain, to make the other less, from Adam and Eve, to make the other less so that they can become something greater than what they have been gifted to become. So, yes, we can talk politics and how the cycle goes round, but I think at this point, this is a gospel heart issue. This is a you will stand before your king issue. This is a It's hindering you from experiencing abundant life issue. This is what it means to be a Christian issue. You cannot continue to be seduced and fall for the default setting, because that wounds others. And that's not what Jesus has called us to be here and now. And if the world never changes, the church has got to. The church has got to, because that's her gospel, that's her mission, that's who she's intended to be. If we need to embody the word victim to change it from being a place of powerlessness to great powerfulness, that's our inheritance. You'll find that with the disciples all the way until at some point where things started to change and became rich and wealthy and stuff like that. But you see my point. Like I could sit and have a long conversation with a Candace Owens about this and that, but because we're not seeing the Jesus and looking at Jesus, we'll get lost in the woods. Jesus compels me to do something that I won't benefit from. He compels me to do something that my brother will benefit from. By my brother, I mean the one who I would have called other had it not been for Jesus. And that's the politics I'm interested in. That's the one. Will I vote for something I disagree with because it will benefit others? That's the politics I'm interested in. It doesn't matter whether you're right wing or left wing. Now love becomes the guiding principle. Love becomes the thing that steers you towards the benefit of the other, even if it's at a cost to you. And I will say this, if people think that the present state of affairs will change without a generation bearing the burden, it's a foolish idea. Ditch it. Someone is going to have to foot the bill for things to change. Someone is going to have to. If we really do this loving thing and embrace one another, we will share the cost. But if we don't, then the burden will be left on others, either to keep things as is or to keep trying to steer towards change.
Yeah. Just a quick note to those listening in, if you want to ask questions, please do put them in the Q&A panel. Dennis, it's again maybe on the sort of the sensitive subjects here, it's one with deep wounds to it. One of the great Christian themes is of being a father to the fatherless. The statistics in UK on families that are fatherless are skewed to the Black community in quite a sizable way. Asian families, 8.8% Black, 24.3% mixed, 19.1% white, another around 10%. So Black and mixed families ethnically having a disproportionately high burden of lone parents. Obviously many lone parents do a phenomenal job. I was watching a friend this week just doing a most amazing job. But there is this Christian theme of putting people into families, and that being a building block for a great society. It feels to me like an important part of a discussion on race and future to think, the roots of this legacy, how much is that to do with our historic sins? How much is that to do with today? Is there something to change in there, or is this not an issue, or is this a major factor in some of the deprivations, inequalities, difficulties going on today in the UK?
Man, I would love to dive into the sort of sex hierarchy in both the sort of slavery and colonial systems across Europe and its impacts on family and the family unit. I would love to dive into what sort of the burden of the sort of, how do I put it, the police landscape over the last maybe 50, 60 or even 70 years have meant for Black men in our society today. In fact, I've got a friend who's listening in. He's a clinical psychologist. We're going to have a conversation further down the line, hopefully on video like this, about the effect on mental health of those who are systemically oppressed. If we let the idea rest that somehow Black men innately have this desire to not have families, then we succumb to one of the most dangerous racist ideas, which puts a characteristic as that's as a result of a system on a particular group of people. The difference between a Black man and a white man is just the pigment on their skin. They're exactly the same. If the statistics are saying something about people with this pigment having a certain outcome in terms of family relationships, then actually what that's pointing to us is that there is something going on in how these people are being treated or have been treated historically, which is leading to this happening.
Yeah.
It's a long conversation. It's a heartbreaking conversation. Again, I'll say Black women, Black females, you guys are phenomenal. Please, please, please don't give up. Carry on. Because what you're doing is incredible. And what you have done all along is incredible. And you'll hear the stories of the mums and the grandmas and the deep wisdom that they have carried, the ethos that they have instilled in people. And I know from my own grandma and my own mum just how important these things are. What I would say specifically, because I'm aiming at the church, and this is my thing here, is really hear the impact of not sharing the peace with people when they came in the Windrush generations and after. Really hear the impact of not inviting people to dinner. Really hear the impact of not looking out for the young Black female, the young Black man who walks past your church doors, of not really being missional in your love. Really hear your contribution to this church. If you embody this call of Christ to feed the stranger, to make home and be one family with the one who looks different from you, this will cease to be a problem in a generation. And I tell you this just to say, don't go rushing in with your band-aids. You have got to be ready to stand and wait until it's clear to everybody else that you're not a mirage and that you're there to stay. To be trusted, it's going to take time. But I need you, church. We need you, church. And this is the Black man saying it. I need you, church, to enter this long-suffering love that is Christ-like, to ask someone to dinner for the fifth time after they've said no, to invite yourself for the 10th time to the park with them, to open your house, your doors for their kids to play, to ask your vicar, ask your church leader whether the church can set up an account for you and those who you know to give money to so that you can randomly surprise a family with shopping or a holiday or something or other like that. Do the practical, loving things, because if we don't become family, if this doesn't become our problem, it stays a Black issue. But if this becomes a church family issue, then we begin to solve that problem in generations. There are children who need surrogate mums. There are children who need surrogate dads, who need good positive uncles, who need folks who would walk with them to job interviews, who would pray them into opportunities, who would be the invisible folks on their knees in the background. They need the folks who will shake their hands, who would teach them how to iron, who would show them how to use a chainsaw. They need those folks. And if we don't do that, church, we are failing our Lord. We're failing what he's asked us to do. We're not living out of the generosity that we have been given. And that's a bigger tragedy than what's at present, because we won't see what we look like clothed in glory, because that's what's on offer. It's show love like I do, and then you'll see what you're supposed to look like. Until then, you're concealed. You're concealed by selfishness. So church, arise. Like, this is our problem. It's not one to wait for the government to solve. If Christians, let's put it this way, if Christians adopted and fostered, we wouldn't have children in care. Let that sink.
Yeah.
Sorry. When we talk about a way forward, I can't help but say this is a chance for us. It's an opportunity, a gift to us from God, really, to place us at this point in time, at this junction in history. Like the apostles had it with that Passover, where people had come from different parts of Europe to celebrate this feast. You know, they had it there. It was their chance in history. The Holy Spirit came and they had to break out of the room and do the thing that they were afraid of doing. They had to go and talk and say, hey, this is what's going on. We have this opportunity now. Like literally, if this is a cultural moment and the eyes of the world are looking, we cannot wait. We cannot wait because they will move and go back to their tents. They'll move and go back to where they've come from. Now they're looking and saying, are you a relevant institution for what we're going through now? Is this God whom you worship actually of importance and consequence to us? We're not going to convince them. That's why by this they shall know. We're not going to convince them by saying. We've got to convince them by doing. We've got to convince them by doing. We've got to be on the front foot with loving. We've got to actually create the system of compassion, because the default is so appealing. If we leave it just to how we feel, we'll go back as quickly as possible. We have to just go and be out there and as committees, as leadership groups, as church leaders, make it a priority to go, we have got to fight this othering that's going on. We have got to wrestle against it. We have got to, each and every one of us, we've got to set examples by inviting the other into our houses, into our spaces of hanging out. We have got to be saying to people in the Father's house, you know, the vicar's called Father in some places. In the Father's house, there are many rooms. There's a garden. Come, let's play. Open house every Saturday. Bring your kids. I'm going to do this. We'll have that. Bring what you have. We'll share it. Bring your food from your culture. Let's dice into that. Yes, it's got chili. Yes, it's got spices. Oh, yours is a bit bland. Here's some hot sauce. We've got to do that. We've got to do that. If we don't do that, we fail. We fail. And the statistics will continue to indict us. They need to be saying in the news, the church has done something in this time that is unheard of. They need to be saying that. And we have an opportunity to do that. Small as we are, we do.
Dennis, I just think you should keep going for a few minutes. But don't let me interrupt you. Yeah.
Sorry.
I'll tell you what, this, you know, I've got a book on my shelf called Reimagining Britain or something like that. And you're reimagining Britain for me as you're talking. You're painting a picture of transformation that isn't so far out there that I can't get involved and do it myself. It's from the individual choice, you know.
It's here. It's
one right heart here. At a time.
Yeah. It's right here. It's right now. Let's put it like this, Rich, and don't take offense to this. For me as a Christian, Britain has no meaning other than just a plot of land. Yeah. So I, like I said, I don't think Britain as we know it will change. I think the church in Britain has got to demonstrate what Britain will hope for and may never achieve as a whole society. This is me at my most realistic. I think human beings are like that. But I think if we can demonstrate something, if we can, and it's so practically simple, if we can just do it in this time, my word, can you imagine going to church like in 3 years? You know, can you imagine going to church in 3 years? Like when love has been the way that people have opted to be, like, yeah. You know, more well, than
that takes me on to a slightly different conversation point where we've talked on before, but not on these seminars, that one of the side products of the lack of love shown by the white churches in to the Windrush generation was the formation of some of the what are now almost historic Black Pentecostal denominations, like the Church of God of Prophecy, New Testament Church of God, I've been privileged to preach in a number of different churches, like that, apostolic churches and others, And one thing that struck me there has been the joy, the, you know, the vibrancy. There's a church I preach in down the road where I can go after our service has finished at Christchurch, and they're just warming up really to the first notices. By then I can get another sermon in, having had coffee at Christchurch. But I get such love, I get such joy, I get a taste of heaven. And it struck me that if everything had joined together back in the 50s or whatever, that some of that passion and vibrancy might have been, we talked about inoculations earlier, it might have been inoculated, some of that passion, with our systems and structures. And maybe, just maybe, there is a gift to God's whole people here in Britain now from that remnant that's been preserved in those denominations and groups. Not that I want there to be a silo now. I'm like desperate to say, wow, wouldn't it be lovely to bring everything together in a great kaleidoscope? In fact, we actually tried to work really hard towards that here at one stage. I'm a great believer that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, even in the mess, even in the sin, even the stupidity. And that sort of vibrancy that's here now and is here with the New Testament Church of God, the Redeemed Christian Church of God now in recent terms, is an incredible gift to Christianity here. But breaking down the walls is not a straightforward thing, is it? And it's not, you know, is it? Give us, did you see any way forward there? Like, it's not like we can suddenly go, you know, come and be an Anglican. or to be honest, where I've rocked up at, as a, not as a preacher, but just as a punter in black majority churches, you know, I'm exhibit A. That's a funny space to be in as well. I've been called up the front and prayed for in front of 200 people, which is, you know, as an exhibit almost. What is there a way that we can bring?
So I suppose this emerges out of a conversation with Bishop Graham Tomlin. And he doesn't mind when he hears me say. I in my spare time I read and listen to theology and lectures. In his spare time, he writes theology. So when we spoke, the term that he hit on was catholicity. And I love this term. And as soon as he spoke about it, I think my insides really warmed. Because the whole point of it is that you are able to acknowledge the church in Judea, Samaria, and this other part, Galilee, as different cultural spaces where faith is being worked out. And the word Catholic is used at that stage to name the fact that these different spaces are united by this Jesus, but they are still different spaces. And what it does is it doesn't give one of the churches prominence over the other. It doesn't. It just acknowledges that actually, the miracle of the unity of difference is at play, not just in the micro communities in these spaces where you've got different people in different families who've managed to come together in this space and are doing Jesus, but you've got different groups of those in different parts of the nation, the country, doing Jesus. And there is a resistance in that word, Catholicity, of a center other than Jesus. And I think there is merit to that in what is to come. If you would have heard, and then this is what I'd say, maybe listen again, those who are listening, you may have picked it up. I haven't mentioned denominations once in anything I've said. And everything I've mentioned has nothing to do with where you worship on a Sunday. Absolutely zilch. It's more to do with the point at which the high point of Christianity is. The high point of Christianity is not Sunday. It's not. The point when you're most Christian is Wednesday in a team meeting with the people you don't like. That's when you're most, that's the high point of your Christian life. That's peak Christianity, is when you're there showing love. The Sunday stuff, that's when you gather with your family. So what I'm saying is practically live out, go engage with the other, invite them into the spaces. If they fit and enjoy and be part of the culture, that's great. But Catholicity means that where we begin doesn't have to be where we end. You know, some people need a seedbed for longer than others. Some people need to be planted in a forest. Some people need to go and dance and let the bass hit their chest as in order to engage with God. And some people need the stillness and the silence. I was having a fascinating conversation over the last 2 days, which had me in stitches about Teze and wine in opposition to bashment music and rum. They're equally both a way of enjoying. Catholicity means that you don't have to shed the denomination, but you can embody the life of what it means to follow Jesus. And so, yes, maybe God in his providence, he knows our hearts, that knew that this issue needed to be confronted when it was fully evident. And he has history for waiting for things to come to their full maturity, whether good or bad, so that you can truly understand the total capacity of it. And maybe in his wisdom, he has kept the silos, you know, so that at this point we can see very clearly indicting us, but also calling us to something, which is, again, a Christian story. At once he calls us a sinner, and at once he offers us salvation. You know, you don't get the salvation without being called a sinner first. So at once we are being called segregationalists. At once we're being called folks who don't do the work of working hard to embrace the other. But at the same time, redemption is being offered in a space that's independent of those silos to go, hey, do you know what? Love doesn't need you to be white. Love doesn't need you to be black. Love needs you to just be able to spot someone and embrace them. And also to interrogate why you did not embrace that other person. Because do you know what? That's who I look like today. Do you see what I mean? And then return back to the space and then invite them back to the space. I've got 2 minutes. I think we've got a question, Rich.
Shall I read it out?
Go ahead.
If love expressed in forgiveness is the essential and inescapable path forward, do we only have a message to the church? On what basis do we make an appeal to the world or nations? Can I suggest, says Craig, giving the question, that loving forgiveness that invites repentance is a powerful apologetic. Sadly, there seems to be a secular demand for change that lacks the intention to forgive. Can we speak to the world, Dennis?
What I would say, forgive me, Craig, I would say love expressed in forgiveness is not actually the essential and inescapable path forward. I think there's this word, it's called forbearance. Forbearance is I know you are crappy. So before we even get to the point where you've offended me so I can forgive you, I'm going to graciously love you. That's forbearance. That's the God mode of thinking. That's the God mode of working. When you are sinners still far off, do you know what? I love you and I chose you before the foundations of the world. Knowing how foul your mouth and your heart is, I still chose to love you and give my son for you. That's grace that goes beyond. And that's what makes forgiveness possible. Because once I've decided to grace you, it's so easy to forgive you now. So the ethic that we're supposed to be proclaiming to the church first, is we have to enter that space of graciousness, which is a generous space. Generosity is impossible without selfishness. So we have to be simultaneously calling out selfishness, but calling people towards an extreme, godly, kingdom-focused, godlike generosity. And then forgiveness flows. We cannot stand and indict the world if we're not doing it ourselves. Try now to step out, especially if you're an Anglican. Give it an example. Go talk to a black man about faith. Now, see what they'll say to you. We cannot talk about faith to people outside. We cannot talk about morality to people outside because in our own house, we have this issue and this ill. By this, they will know, Jesus said, that you are my disciples when you show love one to another. What's love if not generosity? That's not limited by something in the other, but is opened forth by something within you. We have no foot to stand on unless we do this. None. And that's the only way we indict the world, by demonstrating and showing them a kingdom that's not of this world.
Dennis, I've chucked some of my most stroppy, hard questions, even quoting someone, not for antagonism's sake, but just really wanted to hear how you were going to answer it. So thank you so much for your forbearance this evening over the course of this. I was going to say we should let Jesus have the last word, but it feels like Jesus has been the center of your part of the conversation for certain. Thank you so much for what you've shared of yourself and your heart over this series. Those who've listened in have got something from this. So one take home from me and then one from you maybe, and we'll finish. I like that challenge just to go out and love someone, you know, forbear with someone, take a risk, so see what happens, have a go. I think it's just such a great thing. You know, I was trained in outreach with in a sort of to reach out to Muslims when I was at university, and the guy running it was this lovely guy, full of love, and he said Islam stands for ISLAM, I shall love a Muslim. It was such good training. It's just such good training. It's like every person you meet is just a person. Love them and see what happens. And so that's reminded me of that. And I'll be trying to put that into action this week.
I suppose I wanted to just make clear one last thing, which is if you hear me talk about compassion and forbearance and all that kind of stuff, I don't wear a halo.
That's true.
I have been loved, and I've been loved more than I know I deserve.
Wow.
And so I can't rest in the selfish space, because I know what's been given to me. And so I know God's love by the way he has loved me. And that story of the two debtors just hits home. Whoever has been forgiven much does the same. And so that's what I would say is, if you see me trying and attempting to love and failing at it and repenting and attempting to love and speaking it and hoping that we all enter that same rhythm, I'm not a good person. I'm not. I'm a sinner saved. And so that's my sort of check out here, is to say, actually, the foot of the cross is where you need to start. If you've been listening the last four sessions, you will achieve nothing unless you take all of who you are, all of what you have, and bring it, and are ready to let it go at the foot of the cross, because it counts for zilch in comparison to the gift of breath, life, and a calling and a purpose in this time that God is always prepared to give. So you will not love the person on the street unless you know yourself as fully loved. So go to the foot, meet Jesus there, touch his bloody soil-covered feet, look to your left, see his mum standing next to the beloved disciple. Hang about for a bit, ask why that's going on, and then when he mentions your name, you'll know how to love a stranger, because then you'll know how much you have been loved. That's what drives me. That's what's at the core of all of this for me. So yeah, as a sort of my parting shot, that's it. I don't know what else I could say. We better like draw to a conclusion before I start weeping and all that kind of jazz, Rich.
Bless you all for watching or listening in. And from Dennis and me, it's good night. I'll probably be back in the new year with some extra installments for you. But do look out for Dennis's website, dennisadd.com. You get lots of his resources. And if you haven't watched his poetry yet, go and check out the Untitled Lament in particular and go from there. God bless you. Good night. Yeah. See you.